The scientific practice of developing and using models is an iterative practice. As more evidence is gathered, the models need to be continually revised and evaluated. In order to engage students in that aspect of the practice, they are also asked to make revisions to their own models as they encounter more evidence. In this video, we will see the students discussing an additional source of evidence which they use to further revise their models of atomic structure. The evidence that students are discussing comes from a simulation of Rutherford's gold foil experiment. In Rutherford's gold foil experiment, he shot positively charged alpha particles at a thin sheet of gold foil. He saw that most of the particles went straight through the foil. However, about 1 out of every 10,000 particles bounced back close to the direction it came from. After being told of these results, students were given a simulation to explore the relationship between the components and see if they could explain Rutherford's observations. In the simulation, students could see the relationship between the distribution of the positively charged particles within an atom, the effect that had on the electric field, and the path of the alpha particles that passed by those positive charges. In order to mimic the results that Rutherford saw, the positive charges have to be highly concentrated, creating a strong electric field. Students were given time to explore the simulation, and in the video, we will see the whole class discussion of the simulation.
I'm gonna discuss the simulation all together, and then I'll give you some more time to answer the rest of the questions. So I know it's really hard to see up on the board, but what are the components that are shown in this simulation? One component.
You can concentrate
Okay, so we have this like positive blue goo that we can concentrate or have it spread out. The electric field is shown with the green arrows. Remember we worked on those earlier? So the positive blue area, the electric field. Anything else?
The little plus thing.
The little plus thing, so it's positively charged. I can't, so it's not shown right now, but I guess I could. There we go. What's that little blue dot that's coming across?
That is an alpha particle.
All right, so we have the alpha particles that come kind of flying from the left side to the right side, the big.
Yeah.
So that's our gold atom. Because, so in the simulations, blue is always goes with positive.
Oh.
Yeah. All right, so what are some of the relationships that we see? So we have this positive blue area, the positive alpha particles, and the electric field. What are some of the relationships that you guys noticed? Any relationships?
No matter the size of, like, the thing, it doesn't really move at all.
The size?
Of the...
The big blue region, it doesn't move.
It never moves. Yeah, I don't think. No, what, I said no matter the size, like it doesn't.
Oh, it's still in the same spot.
Yeah.
Okay. So it's kind of it has a locked in, like this, the middle of that circle is locked in one location. Okay, all right. Any other relationships? How about, so when it's spread out like this, if I send the alpha particles, what happens? They go straight through. So if the positive region is spread out, alpha particles go straight through. How about if I change the positive region? So it's still in the same location. It's still kind of in the center of our screen. But did anything change? The green things, they're brighter. Okay, so what did that mean? When we were working with the electric fields, what did brighter green things mean?
Strength of the
electric force. So what's then the relationship between the size of that positive area and the electric field? Cole, what's the relationship between the size when I spread out or concentrate that electric area in the electric field?
When you concentrate it more, the green arrows, the force is stronger.
So when I concentrate it more, the green arrows are indicating the force is stronger?
Yeah, because they're brighter.
They're brighter, okay. Gavin, was that what you had, or did you have something to add to that?
that's pretty much what I said.
Okay, so concentrated, the bright arrows are indicating it's a stronger force. And so we said when it's spread out, the alpha particles shoot straight through it. How about when it's concentrated and we shoot the alpha particles, what happens?
It repels a lot.
It repels? Whoa, that one repelled a lot. When it's concentrated, alpha particles repel. How about like this one down here at the bottom of the screen? Is this one getting repelled?
Yeah.
A lot or a little bit?
A little bit.
How about the one that like came from this direction?
It bounced back.
Bounced back? And then again, when we had it diffuse or spread out, alpha particles, did any of them get repelled?
No.
Not at all?
No.
So this one went a little bit up, it looks like. You guys see those dots at the top there? Just like a slightest little bit of a curve. But any of them getting bounced back? So what would we have to do in order to mimic the results that Rutherford got?
Condense them and then concentrate.
Condense or concentrate that positive area. So then what does the evidence from this simulation tell us about the positive in the actual gold atoms?
They're basically really strong. Have a strong electric force.
So they must have a strong electric force because Rutherford actually saw gold, the alpha particles bouncing back, right? In order to get any alpha particles bouncing back, we had to have it really concentrated in a strong electric field. So in the actual gold atoms, must have a strong electric field. Anything else we can conclude about what has to be true about the actual gold atoms? What do you think? It'd be like the plum pudding model where the positive charge is spread out around the whole atom. Let's go back and look at the plum pudding model. So if this is what they thought an atom was like, where the positive is spread out throughout the whole atom, could that be what the atoms are actually like in that sheet of gold foil? Jake, what do you think?
The plum pudding model, the actual pudding is the atom, and then the little plum bits would be the electrons.
So if that's what the atom was actually like, would that be like in this simulation, like this, or spread out?
Spread out.
Okay. And when it was actually spread out, what happens to the alpha particles? Do any of them bounce back? So can it actually be like the plum pudding model? Can it actually be spread out? So what can we say about the positives in an actual atom?
They're condensed, not like in the plum pudding model as they're spread out.
So not spread out, they'd have to be condensed?
Close together.
Like how close? Like this close?
Not very minimum, but.
Like as close together as we can get them?
Yeah.
Okay. So Gavin's arguing in the actual atom, the positives have to be as close together as we can actually get them. Vanessa, what do you think?
I agree with Gavin.
You agree with Gavin? As close together as we can possibly get them? So why? What's the evidence that indicates that they have to be that close?
I don't know.
Well, what did Rutherford see?
Oh, some went through and some bounced back.
Some went through and some bounced back? And in the simulation, so you said you agree with Gavin that they have to be as concentrated as we could possibly get it. If it's as concentrated as we can possibly get it, if I send alpha particles at that, will some end up over here and some bounce back over here?
Possibly.
Possibly? Do you want to test it?
Sure.
Okay, we'll test it and see if we get some go through and some bounce back.
Following the iterative process of scientific modeling, students were asked once again to make revised models of atomic structure that could now account for Rutherford's and Thomson's observations. Students drew these revised models using the draw tool, and you can see some of the sample students' drawings here. Similar to in the last video, these drawings were projected and used to lead a whole class discussion, Importantly, after all of this work, students were able to revisit some of the phenomena they had seen earlier in the unit. For example, the Van de Graaff generator and pie pans. Students could now revise those earlier models and incorporate ideas of atomic structure, electrons, and protons to be able to explain some of the unanswered questions from the earlier discussion. Students could now explain why friction would make an object charged, or why a neutral object is attracted to both positively and negatively charged objects. By going through the process of developing and revising their own models based on evidence, the students were able to use their understanding of atoms to explain their observations.